Hello people, in this video let us look at this schwannoma. Okay, so schwannoma or you can say vestibular schwannoma to be very specific. Basically it is a nerve sheath tumor. So what is this nerve sheath? Let us look at this. So if this is a nerve, right, a nerve has a sheath, and that is the Schwann cell, right? The Schwann cell forms the sheath. Look at this. So you have the nerve, right? And then you have the myelin sheath. So here you have the Schwann cell. So a tumor involving this nerve sheath is the nerve sheath tumor, schwannoma. Okay. So basically what we have to know here, why it is also called as vestibular neuroma, right? That is the specific word, because it affects the eighth cranial nerve. Vestibular schwannoma. Okay. So basically, is this not understanding the spelling? Schwannoma. Okay, it's correct. So basically, it affects the eighth cranial nerve, right? Cranial nerve 8. So, which is the cranial nerve 8? It is vestibulocochlear nerve. Vestibulocochlear nerve, right? So basically, there are two parts to it. The that is the vestibule part of it, and the cochlear part of it. Basically, when it comes to ear, so this is the inner ear, right? So here you can see that this part is the inner ear, right? Are you able to see? So basically, this part is the inner ear, right? This part is the inner ear, and in that you have two nerves going. One from the vestibular part, that is the vestibular nerve, and here you have the cochlear part. Together they become the vestibulocochlear nerve, that is the eighth cranial nerve. It is going to the brain, right? So it is based on the sound that we hear, the cochlear nerve will send the impulse to the brain. But what is this vestibular part? So there is a vestibular part and a cochlear part. So cochlear part will send the auditory information. The vestibular part is going to send the information about the balance, right? Balance. So these canals, so these are semicircular canals, right? You can see these semicircular canals, these canals, you can see three of them here. So basically, these and this utricle, saccule, all these together will send the balance information to the brain. So you have the vestibulocochlear nerve, right? So in that, the vestibular nerve, so this is going to be the vestibular nerve, right? This is the vestibular nerve. You can see that has got swollen here. So that is the vestibular schwannoma. The Schwann cells, that is the nerve sheath of this nerve. So that is involved in a benign condition, that is a tumor. So that will become the schwannoma, vestibular schwannoma. The cochlear nerve is not affected here, right? That's not what they are indicating. So the vestibular schwannoma, right? This much have you understood. So this acoustic neuroma will become wrong. Why? Because it has nothing to do with hearing, right? It is not acoustic, right? So you have understood that part. So this is also called as neurilemoma or eighth nerve tumor. Eighth nerve you can understand, right? Eighth nerve tumor. Okay. So what else you should know here? It's a benign condition only. It's a benign condition only. But the thing is, it is so close to the facial nerve, right? So you can see that the facial nerve is in front. So it is close to the facial nerve, right? So basically, the Schwann cell, which is the nerve sheath, it is a neural crest derived cell, right? So these schwannomas occur at the cerebellopontine angle, at the cerebellopontine angle, okay? So it is attached to what? The vestibular branch of the eighth nerve, that is the vestibulocochlear nerve. So it is attached only to the vestibular branch, okay? So what will be the symptoms in these people? They will have tinnitus, that is ringing in the ear. They can have hearing loss also. So there is that photo to indicate the tinnitus. This one, bring it here. So though it is not the cochlear nerve which is affected, these people have tinnitus and hearing loss. So they are referring it to as acoustic neuroma. It is actually, the correct term is vestibular schwannoma. Okay. So if it is within the dura, what it is, if it is extradural, what it is, read all this, okay? We will move on. So basically this schwannoma is because of loss of expression of neurofibromatosis 2 gene product, that is Merlin. See, neurofibromatosis 2 is a tumor suppressor. It is very good. It makes this Merlin also, which is very good for us. But there is loss of expression of neurofibromatosis 2. There is no Merlin. So there is this problem. Okay. So where is it? It is in the cerebellopontine angle, right? Let's move on. So it's a nerve sheath tumor. Pathology, we have to look at the details, guys. Microscopy, let us look at this. So grossly, what is there? Grossly, we have not written. Let's look at the gross. Let's write the gross here. It is encapsulated, solid, sometimes cystic tumor that produces eccentric enlargement of the nerve root from where it arises. So just learn some things like encapsulated. It's benign, remember. Encapsulated, solid, sometimes cystic. Okay. It's a tumor that produces eccentric enlargement of the nerve root from where it arises. Okay. Hold on. So if it's pathology, this is what you will write. And let's move on to the microscopy. The tumor is composed of fibrocellular bundles forming whorled pattern. So there are two typical areas here, okay? You have the antennae A pattern and the antennae B pattern. Antennae B pattern is so simple. But antennae A pattern, look at these, okay, how they are. Okay, so let's look at the antennae A pattern. Dense and compact cellularity. So antennae A pattern, you can see dense and compact cellularity. Okay, and what is antennae B? Loose acellular areas, antennae B pattern, okay? So now antennae A pattern shows palisade nuclei called Verroquet bodies. Okay, what are these? Verroquet bodies are palisaded nuclei. Palisaded means you can see the nuclei are all like arranged like this, right? So you can see that here, palisaded nuclei called Verroquet bodies, okay? Then what else you should say here? Nerve fibers are usually found stretched over the capsule, but not within the tumor. The nerve fibers are found stretched over the capsule, but not within the tumor. Areas of degeneration contain hemosiderin, lipid-laden macrophages. Okay, so some more details there about it. Let's look at it. What are they saying? Some more details. Nerve fibers are usually found stretched over the capsule, but not within the tumor. What is? Areas of degeneration contain hemosiderin and lipid-laden macrophages. Okay. So hemosiderin will make it brown, right? Hemosiderin. Iron, right? Hemosiderin. Lipid-laden macrophages. I would like lipid to be yellow. Lipid-laden macrophages. Okay. Lipid-laden macrophages. Okay. So these are some other things that you will see in the microscopy. Schwann cells, they express S100 protein. Let's read this. Schwann cells characteristically express S100 protein. So, a Schwann cell origin of these tumors is borne out by their S100 immunoreactivity. So, basically, let's write this in a simple way. Schwann cells characteristically, they express the S100 protein. Okay? So, you will have S100 immunoreactivity. That's all, guys. This rarely becomes malignant. Rarely becomes malignant. So just remember, it is a benign condition only. Okay? This is a benign condition. So we have done the pathology part. Now let us move on to the ENT part. Usually, if there is a neurofibromatosis, then it will be bilateral. Okay? So classification, they have intracanalicular, okay, intracanalicular, when it is confined to internal auditory canal, then you have some small size, medium size, big size, a very, very strange type of thing, small, big, large, okay. So remember, where are we? We are in the ear, okay, we are where? In the ear. So don't forget where we are. So now let us look at the clinical features. How will they be? So this will put, this vestibular schwannoma will put pressure even on the cochlear part of the nerve. So that's why there will be even cochlear symptoms. What will be the cochlear symptoms? We already said tinnitus, hearing loss, right? Then It can put pressure on the internal auditory artery also. Can you see any artery here? So what type of hearing loss will these people have? These people will have sensory neural hearing loss, okay, because it's neural, it's nerve related. So basically remember, usually this will be unilateral hearing loss, okay, progressive unilateral hearing loss. So progressive unilateral hearing loss, okay. Then, so what will these people have? Tinnitus, you hearing loss, what else you want to say? Vestibular symptoms will they have? Vestibular symptoms. So something to do with balance, right? They'll have some vestibular symptoms. What and all did we tell here in the cochlear symptoms? Tinnitus, progressive, unilateral, sensory neural hearing loss. Vestibular symptoms will be like imbalance, unsteadiness. Okay? But they're not saying that there will be true vertigo. The reeling and all that is not there. But imbalance, let's say imbalance. Unsteadiness. Okay. So these are the words they are using. Okay. Guys, now you have to wake up. Now let us look at schwannoma, the cranial nerve involvement, other cranial nerves. Okay. Other cranial nerves, the fifth cranial nerve, that is the trigeminal, is the earliest nerve to be involved. So earliest other nerve which is involved is the fifth nerve. Which is the actual nerve which is involved? The eighth cranial nerve, right? But the fifth one is the next one to be involved. So here this is trigeminal. So trigeminal is involved means what will happen? Reduced corneal sensitivity, right? Now it is coming to the eye focus. It is going to reduce corneal sensitivity, numbness or paresthesia of face. Okay, so basically cornea, something happened. Now we have moved to the eye, now face also some paresthesia. Numbness or paresthesia of face. Okay. So basically it has become big, right? It has become so big, now it is hitting the trigeminal nerve. Next, it will affect the cranial nerve 7. I'm wondering where these things are so close to it. Cranial nerve 7. Guys, before we go forward, just look at the pathology photo here, okay? This is the actual slide. You can see Antony A area very clearly here. The palisade nuclei verrucae bodies, right? This is another photo, not very clear. Let us look at this. This one is quite clear actually. You can see some kind of palisade nuclei here, right? So basically where were we? We were trying to understand what happens if the 8th cranial nerve is affected. They are saying the next to be affected is the 5th cranial nerve, and then the 7th cranial nerve is affected. Where's the 7th? The 7th is here. 7th is facial nerve, right? The facial nerve gets affected next. Okay. So what will happen if 7th cranial nerve, that is the facial nerve, is involved? Facial nerve. If facial nerve is involved, hypoesthesia of posterior meatal wall. This is called as Hitzelberger's sign, loss of taste. This I can understand. Okay, loss of taste. Where in the, loss of taste, facial nerve is anterior two-third of the tongue, right? So loss of taste, reduced lacrimation, this and all makes sense. Reduced lacrimation, right? So what was the first one that they have mentioned here? Hypoesthesia of posterior meatal wall. So something to do with the ear canal itself. Posterior meatal wall. Hypoesthesia. This is called as Hitzelberger's sign. Okay. What is this? This is Hitzelberger. It is behind the posterior meatal wall. Okay. Then delayed blinking reflex, etc. Which is the next nerve to be involved? Cranial nerve 9. Isn't this 9 and 10? That is 9 is what? Glossopharyngeal, and 10 is what? Vagus. So what will happen? There is dysphagia, hoarseness. Okay. So basically there is palatal, pharyngeal, laryngeal paralysis. So you can touch your throat and say palatal, pharyngeal, laryngeal paralysis. So dysphagia, this person has difficulty swallowing, hoarseness of voice. So 9th and 10th cranial nerve, right? So where is 9th? Oh, it's right next to the 8th. So 9th, 8, 9, 10. Okay. So all these got involved now. So what will happen? They are having difficulty swallowing and they are also having difficulty in, hoarseness of voice. Next, they are saying the brain stem will get involved. Okay. They are saying next what will happen? Brain stem will get involved. The person will have ataxia, weaknesses, numbness of the arms, legs, exaggerated tendon reflexes, etc. Next, what will it affect? It's not leaving at all. Cerebellar involvement. So, cerebellar involvement. Is the spelling correct? Pressure symptoms on cerebellum are seen if the tumor is large, right? So, there will be, you can check this by finger nose test, Neal heel test, dysdiadochokinesia. Wow. Ataxic gait, inability to walk along a straight line, etc. Then there can be raised intracranial tension, okay? Because of which what will happen? Nausea, vomiting, headache, diplopia, papal edema with blurring of vision. So next they are saying, raised intracranial tension. So here they are saying sixth nerve involvement. Sixth cranial nerve, abducens is involved. So headache, nausea, vomiting, diplopia, papal edema, blurring of vision, etc. So intracranial pressure also increased, intracranial. So basically what have you understood? So what and all nerves are involved? Now 8th was the one which caused problem. Started with 8th. Then 9th, 10th we saw glossopharyngeal and vagus got affected. Then first one took effect actually was 5th. That was the trigeminal, the cornea. Corneas reduced, reduced corneal sensitivity. Then it didn't spare 6. 7 also affected. 8 was the main one. 10. So 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. So guys, now let us see how we can investigate, diagnose, etc. So schwannoma. Investigations and diagnosis. Very simply we will tell, okay. So what will you do? Audiological test, that is hearing test, etc. Then stapedial reflex test, again everything to do with hearing, right? Then you have vestibular test. So they are talking about hearing, stapedial reflex. Then they are talking about vestibular test, neurological test. So you can, neurological means you can do cranial nerve examination, etc. Guys, how's it going? Is it too much? Just we'll complete it off, okay? Don't worry. So where are we here? Neurological test, then radiological. Radiological. What will you do? Same. Plain X-ray. CT scan. MRI. Okay, CT scan is what? Computed tomography scan. Then MRI is what? Magnetic resonance imaging. This is with gadolinium contrast. This is what you have to know. MRI with gadolinium contrast. Then one more thing they have mentioned here, guys, that is vertebral angiography. Okay. So you can differentiate acoustic neuroma from other tumors. If you have doubt, then you can do this vertebral angiography. Okay. Then again, continuing, they have not stopped here. They're still going on and on and on. That is evoked response audiometry. That is BERA. B-E-R-A. They are saying brain evoked, isn't it? Evoked response audiometry. Again, something you're checking about the response of the brain. Isn't it brainstem or brain in this? It is very useful in the diagnosis of retrocochlear lesions. In the presence of 8th nerve tumor, a delay of greater than 0.2 millisecond in wave 5 between 2 ears is significant. So it's actually brainstem, okay, brainstem evoked response audiometry, BERA. So this graph, it is telling clearly what brainstem evoked response audiometry. So they are saying if between the 2 years, if there is a delay of greater than 0.2 millisecond in the wave 5, where's that wave 5? 5 is here. Okay. Then they are saying let's do CSF examination. Actually, they are saying lumbar puncture is contraindicated. Lumbar puncture is contraindicated. Okay, you should not do lumbar puncture. But if you have CSF, what will you find in the CSF? You will find that proteins are increased. Okay, but you should not do. That's what you should say. Lumbar puncture is usually avoided, not contraindicated. It's usually avoided. Okay. But if ever, for whatever reason, they have CSF, what will you actually see? Proteins are raised. Proteins levels are raised. Okay. So guys, don't worry. We have almost reached the end. We have to just learn the differential diagnosis and treatment of vestibular schwannoma. Okay. So differential diagnosis, DD, of what? Of schwannoma. Okay. What is the differential diagnosis? What shouldn't you confuse it for? What? Okay. So you should not confuse it with Meniere's disease. You should not confuse it with Meniere's disease, because there also there will be vertigo, hearing loss, tinnitus, right? Sensory neural hearing loss, right? Yeah. So, basically you should not confuse it with Meniere's disease, which is nothing but the endolymphatic hydrops, correct? Yes. Then other cerebropontine angle tumors, you should not confuse it with other cerebellopontine angle tumors. So what are those tumors? Meningioma, primary cholesteatoma, arachnoidal cyst. Really, is primary cholesteatoma a cerebellopontine? Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, wait. Let's take a screenshot and put it here. See this. So what they are saying is, so the other cerebellopontine angle tumors, acoustic neuroma we studied, meningioma, cholesteatoma. Schwannoma of other cranial nerves. So other cranial nerves also can undergo schwannoma. Interesting. Aneurysm, Glomus tumor. Glomus tumor is in the middle ear, isn't it? Metastasis. That's a very very generic word they have written there. Okay. So this is the differential diagnosis. Last, we have reached the treatment of schwannoma. Okay. What do you think you can do for this, guys? Just look at this and tell. Take this image. Okay. Now tell what will you do? Surgical removal. Yeah. Surgical removal of the tumor is the treatment of choice. Over. Treatment of choice. Surgical removal. Of what? Of the tumor. Okay. Surgical approach depends on the size of the tumor. So you have different approaches. You have middle cranial fossa approach. Wow. Middle cranial fossa approach or translabyrinthine approach. You have suboccipital or retrosigmoid approach, or you can combine this translabyrinthine and suboccipital approach. So at least remember this middle cranial fossa approach. So you can go from so many places. From translabyrinthine you can go, or you can go via the suboccipital, or you can go directly from middle cranial fossa. This is the middle cranial fossa. Very good. Now, radiotherapy. Now, let's go to radiotherapy. Guys, we are almost at the end of this video. Don't worry. Okay, radiotherapy. Conventional radiotherapy by external beam has no role. So, let's put this in bracket. Conventional radiotherapy, no role. That much we will remember. What you should know here specifically is called as X-knife or gamma knife. Surgery. Oops, what a knife. Knife has a name. X-knife or gamma knife for young people. Actually, it's very interesting, guys. So what is happening? You're giving radiation which is converging on the tumor. So only tumor gets destroyed. So whatever is there in the path won't get destroyed because the radiation is converging and it is strong only at that point. Very, very interesting technology, right? So this is what you have to know about this schwannoma treatment, X-knife or gamma knife surgery. So what it is? It is a form of stereotactic quick radiotherapy where radiation energy is converged on the tumor, thus minimizing its effect on the surrounding normal tissue. Okay, so this causes the arrest of the growth of the tumor and also it causes reduction in its size. It can be used in patients who refuse surgery or have contraindications to surgery or in those with a residual tumor. So interesting, right? So no need to cut open the person and all that. It's kind of interesting. Then, X-knife surgery is done through linear accelerator and gamma knife through a cobalt 60 source. So some specific things here that we may need to write down. Hold on. So what are they saying here? X-knife or gamma knife. X-knife is what? Linear accelerator and gamma knife, accelerator and gamma knife, cobalt 60 source. Okay. Then, cyber knife. There's one more terminology you should know here called as cyber knife. So this is an improvement about, again, over all these. This is totally frameless. It's more accurate. It uses real-time image guidance technology through computer-controlled robotics. See, this gamma knife, nothing is around that guy's head. Through imaging itself, it will put laser and remove the tumor or work on the tumor. Very interesting. So nice, guys. So much we learned in this. Let us look at this completely again. Schwannoma is nerve sheath tumor. Then vestibular schwannoma is one of the examples of the schwannoma. It is affecting the 8th cranial nerve. That's the vestibulocochlear nerve. It's also called as neurilemoma. It's a benign condition. It's also called as acoustic neuroma. And what is happening? Neurofibromatosis 2 gene, the product of it, that's Merlin. There is no Merlin. Right, and the gross how it is, and we saw the microscopy, that is Antony A pattern, Antony B pattern, palisade nuclei, Verroque bodies. Then we saw S100 immunoreactivity. It could be bilateral. Then classification, we have intracanalicular, small, medium, large size. The person will have tinnitus, progressive, unilateral sensory neural hearing loss. Vestibular symptoms can be there like imbalance, unsteadiness. Because of these things, right? Imbalance, tinnitus, progressive, unilateral sensory neural hearing loss. You should not confuse it with Meniere's. That's what they said in the differential diagnosis. Then what are the cranial nerves that are involved? Everything around it. 5, 6, 7, 8 is already involved, 9, 10, okay? Then there can be brainstem involvement, cerebellar involvement, there can be intracranial pressure which can increase. Then what are the tests you do? You will do audiological tests, right? Then you'll do stapedial reflex, vestibular functions test, neurological, that is cranial nerve test, radiological, you can do X-ray, CT, MRI with gadolinium contrast, vertebral angiography to differentiate it from others. BERA, that is brainstem evoked response audiometry, fifth wave, they are talking more about that. Then don't do lumbar puncture in these people. What else? We saw that differential diagnosis, don't confuse it with Meniere's. Other cerebropontine angle tumors, don't confuse it with them. Then what is the treatment? Just remove the tumor. How can you remove surgically? Go cut open and do all those things. But anyways, invasive. But they have found so many things which don't need all that, like radiotherapy, radiations you will give, like X-knife, gamma knife. Now they have cyber knife. Okay. We also saw, what else we saw in this? The cyber knife. This is the cyber knife. We saw the actual pathology slide. Look at some MCQs. True about acoustic neuroma, it arises from the vestibular nerve. So it is true. So why is it red? It should be green. It is correct. The earliest symptom of acoustic nerve tumor is sensory neural hearing loss. So basically that was the earliest symptom. But what is the sign that you will elicit? That is reduced corneal reflex. So in acoustic neuroma, the cranial nerve to be involved earliest is, that is after the 8th, obviously it is 5th, trigeminal. That is why the reduced corneal reflex. So what does this acoustic neuroma cause? Acoustic neuroma causes retrocochlear deafness. After the cochlea, some problem. The nerve, retrocochlear deafness. Treatment of choice for acoustic neuroma, surgery. We already told you. So that's all in this video, guys. Hope you learned something about this schwannoma nerve sheath tumor. Bye-bye.